was thinking to myself just the other night, how good the Lord has been to me. How he left his home above just to show us his love. How he died so we could be free. Oh, won't it be wonderful then? Won't it be wonderful then?
It's wrong key.
Jesus is waiting, we'll soon be celebrating. Oh, won't it be wonderful then?
Let's start again.
I was thinking to myself just the other night, how good the Lord has been to me. How he left his home above just to show us his love. How he died so we could be free. Oh, won't it be wonderful? Is waiting, we'll soon be celebrating. Oh, won't it be wonderful there? He told us he's gone to prepare us a place where time will be counted no more. No sickness, no crying, no sadness, no dying. He's waiting to open the door. Oh, won't it be wonderful there? Think about the loved ones who's gone on before. What a blessed reunion that will be. Our fathers and mothers, our sisters and brothers, so many we're waiting to see. Oh, won't it be wonderful there?
Amen. We're going to try number 356 in the Red Book. Got to do this one every now and then. Remember, Bear?
Thank you.
Red Book 356. We in there.
What a beautiful thought. I've been thinking, sing with me now, concerning that great barrel bird. Remember her name is recorded on the pages of God's holy word. When he cometh descending from heaven, and recorded in God's holy word, I'll be joyfully carried to meet him on the wings of that great speckled bird.
desiring to lower her standard. Think about it. They watch every move that she makes. They long to find fault with her teaching. But really they find no mistake. Back to the first verse. What a beautiful thought I've been thinking concerning that gray speckled bird. Remember her name is recorded on the pages of God's holy word. Amen. If you know this one, sing along with me. I don't know why I'm compelled to do it, but you just are sometimes. B flat. A woman in the Bible days, her last meal almost gone. God sent Elisha to make his word known. Said, "Renamon, won't you worry? God sent me today. And before you even ask him, help was on the way. Just hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. Better time is coming for those who believe and pray. Help won't help tomorrow. You give up today. Just hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. Troubles, let's all stand. Burden gets you down. Think no one's listening. Think no one's around. Just remember what his word said. Trust him and obey. Keep your eyes toward heaven, cause help is on the way. Just hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. Better time is coming. Those who believe and pray. Help won't help tomorrow. You give up today. Just hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. Just hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. Amen. We'll change the order of service now. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you.
Amen.
I want to see you.
And how do you want to see him?
To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing. I am lifted up,
Amen. I want to see him, don't you? Good to see everybody in the house of the Lord. If you like turning your scriptures, we're going to read and start with where we've been reading from Ephesians, but then we will go to 1 Peter 1, and then we'll go to John 3. So we're going to pick up a thought from that to try to continue on where we were this morning. Remember, by way of announcements, remember, no Wednesday night service this week. We will be meeting Thursday night. All right? Come together about 7 and eat together a little bit. You sisters make up your finger foods and your they call it finger foods. I ain't never figured that out. All of mine just about it. I eat chicken. I hold it up my fingers. You know, all of it would be finger food to me and all. But, you know, just fix your things and we'll have a good time. And then after the service is over at 12 or whatever time, we will have something to eat and fellowship together. All right. Remember also, Brother Forney will be with us, the Lord willing, to minister unto us. And like I said, he'll only probably preach for an hour or so. He's not much over that. But then you get your songs ready, you're singing, you're doing, you know, and that way then let Brother Dick know that, hey, if there's time, we'll sing. Because we're going to have to do something from whatever time, you know, we start the service as a regular, sing about 30 minutes, and then we go into the ministry and let him finish, and then we end up the year part of it singing and worshiping and having a good time. So remember to do that, you know, and get everything ready. Remember now, because of the way the days are falling and the things, that the Bible study will be the second Saturday of January instead of the first Saturday. So remember that, if you will. Brother Danny said that they wouldn't give his uncle much of a chance to live, so, you know, they're giving up on him. So let's just keep praying we don't give up until all things are finished, because we believe it and all that, okay? Ephesians 1, 1 Peter 1, and then John. Have you noticed back there, we hadn't said anything about it, I was going to wait till Joe came, and they're down at Brother Collins's with all the family this weekend. But they've put up a sign, he and Brother Richard and them put a sign up. Have you noticed it coming in the doorway?
Yes.
If you look up, now it's a long story behind that about a football team or something, and they go out, this day I give my all. You know, and they reach up and slap the thing, you know, and go out and play it. But if you'll notice what they got on there, this day I give my all.
Amen.
To Jesus Christ. You know, that's all he wants. That's all he wants. So reach up and touch it if you come in, you know, or the side door or whatever, because that's what it's for. Because we're coming in here to give our all for Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay. Now, Ephesians first, and then we'll go to 1 Peter and that. Okay. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace and your love. Thank you for the opportunity to be able to come together with a people in an hour that we can still at this time be able to speak according to the thoughts of our hearts and minds, and not be worried about the law and the things and life, and not being worried about any situations, because we're still a free people. But help us to use that time, Lord, as to what we can do the best we can to prepare against the day when maybe it will be needed in a greater way. So just help us and give us understanding, Lord. Be with each one. Be with Danny's uncle there, Lord, and just touch him, because we don't give up. There's no giving up in us. We even when death comes, we don't give up, because we know there is life after death and can be, you know. But we ask you to just help him and be with him. Be with each one. Be with those that are not here because of the reasons, traveling, families and things, and just let your loving grace be with each one. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. Now, we took it this morning and just kind of broke down the scriptures, but let's go back and read it. It says, Ephesians 1 and 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in Christ, in whom ye also trusted after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. All right, we go then over to 1 Peter 1, 22 and 23. Seeing ye have purified your souls and obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned, that means white hot, the greatest you can get, all right? Unto the greatest point of the truth and obeying it, walking in it, unfeigned love of the brethren, see that ye love one another with a pure heart fervently, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. Now we want to go over to John, and then you'll catch why we're doing this in a minute. In John 3, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. You may be seated. The Lord add his blessing to the reading of the word. Now, we won't be getting into this in a great line, but I want you to notice that in John, it is a requirement. You must be born again. It's not a haphazard. It's not, well, if you want to, it's okay. It's a requirement in God's word that you be born again. All right? Now, Peter then comes over after receiving that new birth, and then he comes to express something to us, and it's right, being born again, which is progressive, and that's true now, so don't forget that. But watch what he's doing. He's telling you there how to be born again. Amen. Right? See, John is telling you you must be born again. Well, all right, then it's needful, if there's a requirement in there, and we'll get back to Jesus and Nicodemus, maybe another message, but my point is to get you to think about that God says you must be born again. All right. Then he tells you how to be born again. All right. Then we just say, well, it's just believing. It's just this, it's that. We'll get into a lot of things, the Lord willing, this afternoon. But all that you would think of may be in a right truth, but I got a thought in mind I want you to get on to think about it. And see, Peter then says, being born again, not by incorruptible, word or seed, because it's seed there, word, but he says it's got to be corruptible, but it's got to be that It is incorruptible. He explains that. All right, then automatically lets us know what the new birth is. Right? We will get back on these things to bring along. The new birth is not shouting, crying, screaming, hollering, and doing this and doing that and seeing this and hearing voices and et cetera. What is it? It's the birth of the Word.
Right. Yes.
Right? Amen. Because that's what Peter says.
Yep.
Being born again.
Right.
And that way, then it starts and don't stop.
Amen.
If it starts, goes so far and stops, then there's something wrong with what you have. Is that right in the natural? So is it in the spiritual. So, you know, then let's think about that. So, I want to preach, and I wish I could preach. It sounds odd for a preacher. But I wish I could preach the gospel until all who are not born again would come to a realization that they need to be born again. If it would take everybody in the building, that would be a great thing. See, most people want to preach, or preachers want to preach, you know, and tell people how good they are, or what this is or that is. But what good is that? You know, we've read and taught many times and spoke about this scripture, you know, John 3, and Jesus requiring to Nicodemus that you must be born again. And then we go through trying to explain this or explain that, and that's all well and good. We've all been through that. And talking about here is the Bible would call him in the scriptures, thou art the teacher of Israel, which means literally, the literal translation is the teacher, which would mean the greatest of all the teachers, you know. And Jesus recognized Nicodemus to be that. Nicodemus had a wonderful record evidently then, and was a great teacher of the Word of God. He had given his whole life and doings, you know, to come to that place that even Jesus would speak of him that way. But we kind of make light of Nicodemus and say, Nicodemus, well, he couldn't understand. You know, Jesus said, you must be born again. He said, you mean I got to go back to my mother and I got to come forth again?
Yeah.
And, you know, we say, well, all he had to do was believe. Well, now I want to approach something to us this afternoon that I hope will help every bit of us in a way to where we can understand. Now, we can spend a great time talking about, and we have, that, you know, you must be born again, and how that you're born wrong.
Amen.
That's on Spoken Word's original seat. Said, why must we be born again, Brother Ryan said. He said, because we were born wrong.
Right.
All right. We can emphasize that, and that's good. We can talk about that those things need to be understood, and that's well and good, but is that all we do is just to stay up on that point? Because thinking about it, that we know why we're lost,
right.
We know what happened in the garden,
right.
All of that, but does that save us? No. Does it save us to know that we're lost? Does it get you out of the woods if you realize you're lost? Oh, boy, Glenn, I'm lost. I realize that.
Right.
Now, which way do I go?
Right.
You know,
right.
You got to get out of here some way.
Right.
All right?
Amen.
But see, then to realize why we're lost is wonderful. We've been over those things with you and talking about it, and what happened to Eve and the points and the things. And all of that's well and good. But now we've come down to a basis of thinking about, like the prophet said there on Spoken Word of Written Feet, he said, why must we be born again? And I asked that question this afternoon. Why must you be born again? Yeah. We could put forth a lot of our statements and talking about it, you know. But, you know, we can say we're born in sin from Eve's sin, spoken words, written of seed. We've got it. We can go through everything. But after all is said and done, why must you be born again? Well, we're born wrong. Well, that's good. But why must we be born again? Why was it not okay to continue on with the great understanding that the religious leaders had of the word? Yep. And Nicodemus being the greatest of all of them with his understanding. Why does it emphasize to him, you know? Well, the basics of saying it is like Jesus said, you know, you must be born again. He said, can I enter my mother's womb, come forth again? You know, is that what you're meaning? He said, no. He said, if I tell you earthly things and you don't understand them, he said, how can you understand heavenly things?
Right.
Well, he's making then, if you'll follow that thought, he's making the born-again experience, or that you must be born again, something that should be understood.
Right.
Right?
Amen.
Because he emphasizes if you can't understand earthly things. Then he goes on to explain, we'll get back into that, that born of water, born of spirit, we'll get back into that of justification, sanctification, the baptism of the Holy Ghost. We'll get into those things as we go along. But I want this emphasis put in right here as a thought in your mind. Why must we be born again?
Amen.
Well, Jesus gives the key there in John. And he says, if you're not born again, you won't see the kingdom. All right. He drops down a couple of verses from where we just read. It's in the third chapter, a third verse. He drops down a little bit, you know, and he enters another word there. And he doesn't just say what he's saying above, because he's emphasizing something. And he says, if you're not born again, you can't enter the kingdom.
Right.
Yeah. See, we've got it all, the emphasis. We know, yeah, see means to understand. We can't understand. But see, Jesus takes it to a higher depth or a thought that you cannot enter the kingdom. Because you may be able to see or understand certain things. You can read the Bible to understand about the kingdom. The parables, all of those things are talking about the kingdom. And we'll get into it later of some of those things that's being said about the kingdom that maybe might emphasize more of the point that Jesus would say, you cannot enter. Because you'd be able to physically see some things, and at least in your mind be able to think about some of the other things of understanding the kingdom. But after all of that's done, the emphasis is you can't enter. Now, lay it all back to the point. If you can't see it, you can't enter.
Yep.
Is that right?
Right. Yeah.
If you don't know you need to enter, you couldn't enter.
That's right.
Right?
Right.
So we're wanting to try to emphasize something this afternoon. When you look at the man that he's talking to, now listen, I know the story, so don't go ahead of me and saying this. I know Jesus had not been crucified and the Holy Ghost had not been given. So just stay with me. instead of trying to figure it out or saying, I know why. I know why. See, you sit there and you're cutting off all that's being said to you when you spend 10 or 15 minutes saying how dumb this guy is. You don't understand Jesus couldn't do this because the Holy Ghost has not been given, because Jesus has not been crucified. See, then you spend your whole time and you're not getting a thing in the world that I'm saying. Amen. All right? See, I want you to think with me. All right? Why would Jesus tell this man that was pure in his life, pure in his lineage, wouldn't be where he's at if he had any problems? True? What about this man that had no sin? Now, I didn't say he wasn't a sinner. I said he had no sin. He was born a sinner. Maybe he understood that, but he knew how to get rid of that too by repentance. Now, you say, well, how do you know? Well, why wouldn't Jesus have made some stipulation? Well, what you need to do, Nicodemus, you've cheated these people out of this money. You sinned in this. You go get that straightened up. Come back. We'll talk about it. He did in other cases, right? Why did he not put a requirement upon Nicodemus? Well, Nicodemus just wasn't a believer. Well, he must have been a pretty good believer because he came to Jesus. And remember, his life was on the line if his buddies found out where he was at. Right? Are you one of his followers? You know. You say, but what about him? This man had given his entire life to the studying of God's word and the serving of God and his church. You know what I'm talking about. Building, worshiping, doing temples and all of the regulations. So if being good is all that's required for us to be born again, if serving God is all that's required, if confessing Jesus is all that's required, why are you going to throw Nicodemus out? Right. You said, but he didn't... You ain't reading the scripture. Because it said, I think, in the second verse there that we know that thou art a great man. How is that? Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God. For no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Now, what about it? So, in essence, what was Nicodemus confessing? You're come from God. You're a prophet. Wouldn't that be a simple way of stating it? He was confessing him to be a prophet. Because he was saying, you know, no man can do these things. All right? Now, he came to him. He took a chance on all of that. He confessed him as coming from God. He had lived a great life. He had no sin against him. Is that all we have to do to be born again? Is that what you're depending upon as to be your salvation. Well, Brother Dale, you don't believe in living good? No. Boy, you walk so hard, don't you? I don't believe in living good because you can't live a Christian life. I believe in being a Christian and let him live. Because if it's all he's doing is you living it, you're the same, you're Nicodemus. He's got you beat. You can't deal with it. That's what I'm laying down, a thought in your mind of a question. Why would God tell, you know, Jesus Christ, tell Nicodemus, you must be born again? When all he had was, looked like a great opportunity to be called a good Christian. Right?
Amen.
You understand what I'm talking about? How would Nicodemus fit in today? How would he fit in to with you and I today? A good life. Wonderful thing. A serving of God. A wonderful point. Living in the church, as we'd call it, you know, taking care of everything, doing everything. And a good believer. We believe Brother Branham to be the prophet. We believe that he come from God. We believe every bit of that, Brother Dale. So it must mean that I'm born again. Does it? But now, can it be done that way? And us think that. Nicodemus was doing it. So I hope you understand the point I'm making. Because I don't think we would be illiterate, spiritually speaking, enough to think that we are living a better life than Nicodemus. That we are doing better than he was doing. That we are confessing God more than he was confessing God. Remember, this man lived in the church. You remember? He was there. That's all he done. Was study the Word of God. And, you know, we'll get to it in a minute. Brother Brown says Nicodemus and Gamaliel will be given eternal life. Huh? But is it that we just must confess we believe the message? You know, because I mean, come on. It said, you know, what does it do? Believe in your heart, confess with your mouth. But if you'll notice, it doesn't say you're saved. What does it say there? I believe if you'll check it, the last time I remember reading it, that it said, and thou shalt be.
Right.
Not you are,
right.
But you shall be saved.
Right.
Right. Because if it's all it is a confession and a good life, what would you say if you had a church full of Nicodemuses? What was the difference in Nicodemus and his confession? Now I'm asking you this question. What was the difference in Nicodemus and his confession and, say, Peter and his confession? You remember? When man said, the Son of Man am, he said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Thou art that prophet that was to come. Well, what is Nicodemus saying? I want you to think. Now, listen. What would you have to condemn him with? Because you do not find the Lord Jesus condemning him. So if there was anything that was any form of sin into the man's life, Jesus would have first had to approach the sinful condition. And he never did it. Okay. Jesus' grave gave great honor to Nicodemus to say later on that thou art a teacher, the teacher of Israel. Well, see, we can go back and we can say, as we've been through it, that, well, the, you know, the priests and things, he didn't have no representation in heaven. Well, that's good. But may God help me to express something. What are you going to say about Nicodemus? Nicodemus' confession on earth would have been his confession in heaven, right? You remember this morning?
Yes, that's right.
That whatever was there before the world, him stood as a lamb slain before the foundation of the world, meant that he would have to come down here and die.
Right.
And if he would predestinate to you and I by foreknowledge as to be in this message, to be saved, etc., we're going to do that, right?
That's right.
Because that God saw that it would take place.
Right.
This is going to match that, or we're not matching up.
That's right.
All right? So the priest back then said, you're Beelzebub.
Okay.
Well, you know what? That's what they said before the world.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Right? But before the world, the little woman said, and she started off, we'll get to her in a minute. She said, you're a prophet. Then she progressed in her understanding to actually confessing him to be the Messiah. And that he would be the Christ. And telling others about him. What about Nicodemus then? You know that Nicodemus and Gamaliel, I believe it might have been Gamaliel stood up, but anyhow, one of them stood up, you know, and said, you better leave this alone when they were talking about what to do with the Lord Jesus.
Right,
said, because we've seen these guys come up before and all of this happen and all that, and said, just leave it alone. Said, because if it's not of God,
right,
it will come to naught.
Right.
Pretty good confession. But he said more. He said, but if it is of God, you will happily be found fighting against God.
Right.
You know, they didn't want to listen to him.
Right.
But that was his confession. Huh? You say, but the prophet explains that the priest had no representation. He didn't say Nicodemus, he said the priest.
Right. Yeah,
huh. That's no problem. But you say, what about Nicodemus? What was Nicodemus's representation in heaven? The little woman, her representation was that she said, thou art the prophet, thou art the Christ. Reflected to earth, and she would say that. Well, what was Nicodemus's point? How far away from her as his confession or representation was it? Because his representation in heaven would be the same thing that he done while he was on earth.
That's right.
Right.
See, he must have had some form of representation, because that's where we have the prophet's word to depend upon, that Nicodemus and Gamaliel will be given eternal life. But yet he talks about the little woman of the well receiving or coming with eternal life. Do you understand what I mean?
Yes.
Here's one priest that calls him a Beelzebub. He's a devil. This man, he's an impostor. You know, he's a false prophet. Well, here's Nicodemus moving on up into a closer point. That his representation in heaven was the same thing that he done while he was on earth. See, he must have had some form of something. You know. Because that's what your prophet says. Now, that's why we're glad we have a prophet's message where we can read it. And then that way, you might argue with me, but you argue with him, you got a problem. And that's your problem. But go ahead, pull up number one, let's read. While they're bringing it up, this is from the Sardinis in Church Age 278. And he's talking about the Book of Life. And remember, there is the Book of Life, and it contains many things. And there is a Lamb's Book of Life that contains the names of the eternal life. But it's both called the Book of Life. Everybody with me?
Yeah.
It's all called a Book of Life.
Yeah.
It's not two books.
Yeah. Right.
What is it? Two sections of the same book.
Right.
All right. Now, so think about it. He does not call these sheep. You know, I mean, you know, he calls them sheep, but not on the point that we understand. He's not separating sheep from goats, as a shepherd would do. These are not sheep in this particular area of time. White throne judgment. All right. The sheep are in his fold. They heard his voice, word, and they followed him. They already have eternal life and cannot come into judgment. But these do not have eternal life. And they're in the judgment. All right. Now notice what it says. Roll it up where we can read the last part, because that's what I want to emphasize. They are not heirs to anything but life. They are not like us who have joint heirs, etc. These here are, they share no throne with him. Their names must have been in the Book of Life and not removed. All right. Now, because of their love, you know, for the people and the thing of God, they're recognized and saved. No doubt these served and helped the children of God. Perhaps Nicodemus and Gamaliel, they stood for the children in the time of trouble. All right. So Nicodemus has got a greater representation than the priest, because the priest that would call him Beelzebub is just blotted out. Even though his name was there on records as to being part of a religious society, read the Church Age book right around where that's at, about 10 or 15 pages before and after that statement, or page 278 of the Church Age book, read that. Brother Branham explains the four classes of people and what it is and what's going on. And he's explaining the Book of Life and the Lamb's Book of Life and the things. So Nicodemus has enough representation in heaven till he's given eternal life. Right? He never called Jesus a false prophet. He called him a prophet, if you want to say anything about it.
Rabbi.
Rabbi.
Teacher of God.
Do you understand what I'm getting at?
Yes.
But you know, the little woman, she has a horrible life. She's a prostitute. She's on the streets. She's all messed up. Had five husbands. One she had wasn't hers, which means they're just living together. But what was the difference in her now than Nicodemus? Nicodemus had a great life, had all, everything was perfect. Right? He was a great believer. He come to Jesus. He confessed him of who he was. Rabbi. A prophet. What's the difference in her and him?
Right.
Looked like we're picking the wrong person. You know, that's the way Brother Branham would explain about Esau and Jacob, right? Remember, Esau have I hated, Jacob have I loved, but Brother Branham said Esau was the better man.
Right.
Right. So what was the difference? What would you say about this? When Jesus would say you must be born again. See, the original translation says, you must be born from above. Because that's what would throw Nicodemus off so much. Until the best answer he could have, now go back to my mother's womb. But he knew that he wasn't saying that. That's just all he could comprehend. Because the original was that Jesus was saying, you must be born from above. Now listen, may I paraphrase it this way? Paraphrasing what Brother Branham says, you must be born from where I was born from. Remember, it's his kingdom. So you can't see his kingdom. And you can't enter it unless you know what it is. Oh, we've argued over there, you know, and we'll get into it in another message. We've argued that one in Luke, you know, where it says that the kingdom of God is within. They've argued whether it was out here over there, or was it in Jesus, or was it in the people, or what it was in, you know. That's an argument among organized religion, because they can't comprehend it, just like Nicodemus couldn't comprehend what Jesus was saying. Remember, what he says is what he had before the world. The confession he would make here would be the confession he made would be back there in God's foreknowledge. Remember, your confession right now is exactly what you had before the world. Your thoughts right now are exactly the thoughts you had before the world that made God do in his foreknowledge what he would do. Well, I was thinking about making a cake when I got home. I was thinking about, sure, he sure is. I don't understand him. He's just all confusing. Remember, that's exactly what was before the world. You don't fool with God's foreknowledge. Because remember, we got tape recorded. Ain't that wonderful that they brought it out in this dice days to where, you know, I mean, you can see the judgments. You can see all kind of things. You know, I'm talking about the judgment seat, the white throne, the different things. You can see it by just going, turning your computer on, turn your TV on, turn your video on, turn your cell phone on. Yeah. Click, and there it is. You can see it. Well, you know what God had to do? He just go, hey, you want to argue about it? Ploop. I remember a man at work one time that he would... He had got into a discussion. Now, maybe some of you told me about it, but a discussion this man did, or somebody told me about it, about a Church of Christ man with a Pentecostal brother. Got into an argument over scriptures. Well, the old Church of Christ man said, well, come down to my office where we can talk. He wanted him there for a reason, because when they sat down, you know, the guy'd say, okay, what do you got to say? And the Pentecostal would say, so-and-so. He'd go, bloop, scripture would pop up on the screen. You know, there it was. He'd say anything else, he just, bloop, there was the scripture. Well, you know what happened, and I'm not throwing off on anybody. Who told the story? It was told, it, I guess, was true. But said the Pentecostal guy just started speaking in tongues and shouting, just fell over on the floor like he passed out. Well, you know, he probably left saying, the Holy Spirit convicted. He beat that man. No, the guy had him defeated with the scriptures. Then he just pull him up in front of him. He just push a button. Well, that's all God's got to do to your life and mine.
That's right.
So we ought to be careful the way we think, not just in church, but all the time, because it's, you know, remember what the prophet said, that our thoughts is what? Louder in heaven than our words on earth. All right, but what are you getting at? I'm getting at what would be the difference. We can argue the priest and no representation. We can talk about him saying, well, Jesus was Beelzebub. And, you know, we can throw him one way and bring her the other way. But there's a middle of the road. And a Nicodemus. And what if we are that Nicodemus? What if we're just great believers? Now remember, you'd have to say one thing. Nicodemus was a confessor, a believer, but he didn't possess what he confessed. He possessed what he did in life and his doings and his being good, but he couldn't follow it alone. But see, we all know the little woman at the well went on to receive eternal life somewhere. All right. What was the difference? If that's all we got to do is be good, go to church, claim the message. If that's it, why doesn't God save everybody? What did he not say to Nicodemus? Let's bring it down to the message, people. Okay. Why didn't Jesus say, Nicodemus, I want you to know, by looking at your life and the way you've been, you must be a predestinated seed. So all you got to do is just believe. Right? Because if you believe you had this predestinated seed, and you come with a predestinated seed in you, which was eternal life, and you already have an eternal life, you don't need Jesus. You've broken your own case. You don't realize it. You don't need Jesus. All you need to do is come to a knowledge of who you are. Let me say it strong. Nicodemus knew who he was.
That's right.
He knew he was a Jew. He knew he was the children of God, the chosen. He knew he was circumcised. He knew he had all of the rites of the Bible taken care of. If being good's all it is, then why didn't Jesus say, Nicodemus, you already have it? Just come on, old boy, and follow me. Let me ask you that question. Why did not Jesus pick out Nicodemus and say, come and follow me? He picked out tax collectors. He picked out fishermen. He picked out all of them and said, come and follow me. Right? Why didn't he tell Nicodemus, come follow me? Because you see, church, listen. This man that was sitting there before Nicodemus was the Almighty God, right? And Almighty God already knew that's as far as Nicodemus could go. He probably hugged his neck and said, Nicodemus, I love you, but you just can't understand. What else could he say to the man? Because get to what I'm saying. This man had everything right.
Amen.
But he said, Nicodemus, you must be born again. You must be born from above. You must be born from where that I was born from. Let's see. I didn't give him this now. What is the Holy Ghost? 1959. We walk by the power of the Spirit, who is our true seal, our true advocate, our true comforter, our true sign that we have been born from above. Because that's what the original translation says. There's about 40-something statements in your computer on born from above. Run it in and read them. He says on the message, why I'm against organized religion. The first birth to make us active here makes us mortal man. Because of the sin act at the garden made man come into the world by a woman. And a man that is born of a woman is of a few days, but a man that is born of Christ is eternal. Job said, a man that's born of a woman is of a few days and full of trouble. But notice, a man that's born of Christ has to be born from above. But a man that's born to the earth, he's just earthly. Do you see what Jesus was saying to Nicodemus? You got to be born from where I was born. And that just stopped Nicodemus totally from any understanding. Of course, we got it all figured out. Poor old Nicodemus. You ain't come through the Baptist. You ain't come through this message and listen. All Nicodemus had to do was believe. I'm laying it down to show you he was a great believer. A great man. Why was he not chosen? Should leave it right there and not say no more. It'd give you a while to think. That's why you don't hear Brother Dale preaching like everybody else, you know. Quit this, quit that, don't do this, don't do that. What did Brother Brown say? He said, they said to them, what must we do to be born again? He said, we tell them what to quit. Yeah. Now, I'm quoting Brother Brown, whether you believe it or not, I'll give it to you. He said, we tell them to quit, what not to do or what to do. He said, that wasn't the question. The question is, how can I be, or I want to be born again? What about it? You see, I even wrote my note like this about Nicodemus serving God, living good, and doing good has its rewards. Nicodemus will be given eternal life at the white throne judgment. A cup of water in my name. Yeah. Yeah. Right? But you must be born from above. You got to be born, Nicodemus, where I'm born from. Yeah, right. And that's why Nicodemus said it that way. He said, but you came out of a woman. I know where I'm at here. Are you saying I got to go back and come out again? He said, if I tell you earthly things, what was the simple thing that he said, but you can't understand the heavenly thing? He said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. There was no way Nicodemus could follow that thought. Because there was no record in the Bible that Nicodemus could go back to. And say, the Bible says that somebody's going to have to come and die. Oh, you got Isaiah 9:6. You got all of the crew. But you can't put it in there as to bringing it down to like seeing that a man's going to do this. Right. But listen. All that Nicodemus had. He had on earth of a representation of being good, studying, a good life, a good believer, a good confessor, and doing all he could do for the kingdom of God. But yet, the little woman had a horrible life. But yet, she had representation in heaven. So we ought to certainly know that God is not picking and choosing. That's the point, folks. I've laid it down for 25, 26 sermons that it's not God picking and choosing. Because he was picking and choosing, he'd have to choose Nicodemus over all the Peters, the John, the Jameses, all that he chose. And you and me. See? What's the difference between Nicodemus and the little woman? What would you say the little woman had? That would make God seemingly choose her. What are you going to put it on one day when you're required to stand the judgment? Oh, we aren't going to watch on judgment. I didn't say nothing about it. I got enough sense to know there's two judgments. But I got enough sense to know we're going to all stand before the judgment seat of Christ according to the Scriptures and give an account of the deeds done in the body, whether good or bad, according to the Scriptures. Not the white throne. No, no, no. There's two judgments there in the Bible you have to deal with. No, we're not. If our name's in the Lamb's Book of Life, you know, eternal section, we're not going before the white throne. We've done read that from the prophet. What was the difference then between Nicodemus and the little woman? Well, here's the message, people. Oh, she had this seed in her. And Nicodemus didn't have it. Well, then God was picking and choosing. I'll go with you. She had the seed in her because Brother Ryan said she did. But what was that seed? God only has one seed. And that's his word. Right? Now, if I go a little long this evening, you go to sleep, do what you want to, get up and leave, forget it. I may take a little bit of time because I got a point I want to get to, okay? What was that seed? When God's seed is his word. Oh, that's what it was. We was born with this little word in us. I'll go along with you if you know what you're talking about. But not too good because you remember you're going to have him putting something in you. Instead of just leaving it and letting you come in earth and seeing it here and then knowing that what you're seeing and doing here was what he saw and you and knew you'd do back there.
That's right.
Okay. What can you say of the little woman that would make her to be able to be born again? When all Nicodemus had and was only got him to a point, not that he could be born again, but that he could be, as we call it, a foolish virgin and receive eternal life. Because I didn't answer that. It's your prophet. You read it. 278 of the Church Age book. What did she have? Go ahead with number two now. It's taken from the future home of the heavenly bridegroom and the earthly bride. Paragraph 132, I'll be quoting this over and over and over and over. But look what he says. And this little woman, her life, her first life up here was a prostitute. She was all marred up. But way down in her, here, way down in her, here, was just a little bit of understanding I know when the Messiah cometh. See, that was there. And she had just a little understanding of God's word. I mean, I said it this way, we're not throwing off on it. What about the great understanding Nicodemus had about the word? Now, come on, folks. Let's don't let them be dummies. Go over and talk to them. Those people are not that away. They're not just sitting there. Well, we're the people of God. We don't need to. They're studying that word over and over and down all day long. That's all they do. The story's been told. They take a scroll, stick a pin in it, and they tell you every word it went through. Why would a prophet say that she had just a little understanding? When Nicodemus had the greatest of understanding, he was called the teacher. That means the greatest of all the teachers. That's the original translation. It says a teacher, but it said the teacher. Well, here's a little woman that says, but way down in her, here was just a little bit of understanding. I know when the Messiah cometh. See? That was there. Priest called it intellectual learning. That's what his was. But by him, he would call Jesus the devil. I'm reading on down. But that's what his denomination called it. Because you see, if you listen to what it was, the priest had only representation from what he had heard and learned on earth. Lean not to your own understanding. They don't have to pull this one up because it's just a fast quote again. She come, said come, and see, talking where she went and what she done. Isn't this the very Messiah? She never leaned upon her understanding. Now let's study her for a minute. So go ahead and get number four. Let's think about in the scriptures what was going on. This is a split. You'll see it. Jump in the scripture. Save time. Read it. Look. For thou hast had five husbands, in whom thou now hast is not thy husband. In that saidest thou truly. The woman said unto him, Sir, I perceive thou art a prophet. Why? Because he knew her life. Now that's where her confession starts. That he's a prophet. She doesn't say you're the Messiah. See, that's all we do. We don't read the Bible. She says, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Jumping down to save reading, verse 25, it says, the woman saith unto him, I know that Messiah cometh. See, she's beginning to relate the scriptures that we're going to quote some in a minute. Which is called Christ. When he has come, he will tell us all things. Okay. Now Jesus speaks to her and says, what? I that speak unto thee am he.
Amen.
She says, we know that when the Messiah, and that's where, when you're running in your Bible, you have to run this Messiah. It's not spelt Messiah like we read it a lot of times. It's used twice as Messiah of that form. But see, her understanding goes from what? He's a prophet. Nicodemus said he was a prophet. Right? You was with me a while ago, so now If you don't believe in something, don't shake your head. You know, go this way, if anything. Because you was sitting there listening that Nicodemus recognized Jesus to be a prophet.
That's right.
But Nicodemus never mentioned he was the Messiah. A teacher? A great man. She goes back to her little understanding of the word. First, recognizing that a prophet could call out her sins. That he would be a prophet. But then she goes to the point of where that she's going back to her understanding. We know when the Messiah cometh, which is called Christ, when he is come, he will tell us all things. Now, if you run Nicodemus down and say, well, Nicodemus, you were leaving over there. I want to talk to you a minute. You recognize him as a prophet. Yeah, I believe that. He's great. But what about the Messiah? I can't go that route. No representation for him to go that route. Right? Remember, whatever the little woman said on earth was what was before the world that made God look at it and predestinate. Come on, are you following me?
Yes.
All right. Look, Jesus just confirmed it by speaking. And like I'd say, I know that you're Wade Dale. You're the son of Samuel Dale. And when you come, you'll be these things. And he, well, yeah, that's what I am. Well, that didn't spark up so great a thing. But when she said to him, and I've got a quote in here, Brother Brown said, that's all he wanted her to know. That's all he wanted her to know. That he was the Messiah.
Yes.
Yep. Right. Yep.
When saith unto him, I know that thou art Messiah. I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he comes, he'll tell us these things. Jesus said unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. What did she do? Nicodemus packed his duds and went back to his buddies. Sure, he defended things. He tried to help Jesus and tried to tell him, you know, don't do this or don't do that. He tried to help because he was a good man. But he packed up his duds and left and never said he was the Messiah. What did she say? Well, this, but upon this came his disciples and marveled that he talked with the woman. Yet no man said, what seekest thou, or why talkest thou with her? The woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city and saith to the men, which is contrary to anything, Brother Brown said, she wasn't supposed to have done it. Saith to the men, what? Come see a man which told me all things I ever did. He was a prophet. He told me everything I ever did. Surely he must be a prophet, but it went further. She said, is not this the Christ?
Amen.
Brother Brown said she come to life. And I believe that.
Amen.
But she wasn't born again until the day of Pentecost. I believe that. Because she couldn't have eternal life until Christ had come. But she had a little bit of understanding. Brother Branham goes on in the future home and says, she was one of his attributes. He said the priest only knew it by intellectual conception. He learned it by what had happened, not what was happening.
Amen.
Come on, you got it up there? Paragraph 157 is where it's at. There was a reference to light. It learned it from the Bible. She learned it from the Bible. He had learned that God was God. She learned it. He had learned that holiness was right. She didn't do too good on that. Weren't cutting off. She's out of the picture. He was learned that there was a law of God. He had learned it because of an intellectual conception. And he was born in the right lineage. He was a Levite. but he only knowed it by intellectual conception. And when the light of the hour, right. See, you learned it by what had happened, not what was happening, what had happened, and when he found what was happening, his denomination said nothing about it. Therefore, he had no representation of it. What about it? You remember this statement we gave off him proving his word? That she had representation from predestination. If she hadn't had representation from predestination, it'd have never took hold. Is it on there? She looked around and what? A sinful shape she was in, but see? He couldn't get that priest because a priest was an educated scholar, a theologian in the word, no representation in heaven. See, wasn't in God's thinking at all. But this woman was said, sir, I perceive that you're a prophet. That's just all he wanted her to see. You reading it? That's all he wanted her to see. You know what? He didn't explain the seals, the vials, the plagues, the trumpets. Right? He didn't holler and scream about, you need to know this, you need to know that. All he wanted her to know that he was the Messiah, the Christ. That's her little understanding of the word. Compare that with what he had. Well, look at all of them. Well, going down. Get number 7, which is John 1:41. He first findeth his own brother Simon and saith unto him, we have found the Messiah, which is being interpreted to Christ. Pretty good confession, wasn't it? That's the same confession she had. See, other people have had a lot of confessions, is my point. These went on to a possession. I believe the little woman went on, don't you? Token message, I believe it's in Jeffersonville. And Brother Brown said, anybody knows that little woman was predestinated. Matthew 16:15 says what? He said unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And he goes on to say what? Upon this rock I'll build my church. Had a pretty good confession, didn't he? But remember, she had the same confession. Brother Brown calls it a little understanding of the word. Jump on over to number 9, the future home, which would be to paragraph 134. So I guess you'd have to roll it on up, but she had a little understanding. But notice, way down in her, she's got representation. And then she was looking for this to be made flesh. She was looking for the Messiah. Nicodemus was looking for the Messiah. But he was trying to figure out in his own way. All she was doing is just taking what he said. We know the Messiah, which is called the Christ, will come. And when he comes, he'll do this. He said, I'm he. No more doubt. You didn't have to explain it. She saw it and she believed it. Away she went. Why? What did it do to her? Redeemed her. Brother Brown said on the voice of the sign that there was a little woman, a prostitute. For life up here was black as it could be. She was ill-famed, but down in her heart, she was predestinated to life. Going down to the voice of the sign. Listen, wait a minute. It's in the same part. Excuse me, paragraph 61, part of it. There was a seed laying there, a predestinated seed, that was in the, it was God's thought before the foundation of the world. What is the predestinated seed that's in you? A little understanding of the Word of God. Identified Christ of all ages, says down in her, the ill-famed prostitute, her heart, well, she had a representation of one of God's thoughts. Then came Jesus and called. 64. She said, I don't know what to do. I'm in distress. I've been reading the Bible. Surely someday that prophet will come on the scene. She's been reading the Bible. Go on down to paragraph 150. And there was a little seed laying down in her heart. Says, if it ever happens, I'll know it. Remember what the priest was built on, what had been, what was the woman at the well, and what is taking place. She was predestinated. What about it, church? What about it? Why must we be born again? we're born in sin, shipping in iniquity. Okay. Why is it not that just being good would not bring God to the thing? And why would God himself say, I'm sick of your offerings? They have become a stink. I'm reading the Bible, quoting it. They have become a stink in my nostrils. The sacrifices he ordained for them to make. Read your Bible. But what does each to look at? What does God look at? Said a man with an honest and a contrite heart. Now, what was the difference in the little woman and Nicodemus? Nicodemus had an honest and a contrite heart. But there was something wrong. He had a great understanding, but there was something wrong. His understanding was from earthly happening and earthly doings and what he read and what he studied and how he prepared. It was all based on what had been. Right? But to the little woman, it was based on what was right there then. Isn't it wonderful the prophet would say, that's all he wanted her to know. You know what happened? Okay. I'll take a minute and quit. Because this has been on my heart for 40-something years, and I've tried to explain it. Brother Brown said she had a little understanding of the word. He said, there's a word or seed to be forever age of life. You don't have the first church age coming in the second church age. There's a seed for that age, a seed for this age, a seed for that age, a seed for that one. That's why it could never be until the end time that all the word could come forth. But we're here with all of the word coming forth. Why can't you think about something right now? I'm not throwing off on Brother Branham. You just go ahead. You say what you want to about me. I'm the guy that does the reading that believes him. And you say you don't believe it. Well, I'm doing the best I can. Brother came in the front door of here one day, said something about all the believers a certain thing. I just opened the door and let him in. I didn't argue with him. I said, we believe a little bit of the word. And then just went on. I wasn't going to argue with him. Because I'm not made that way. A certain brother made a statement about me one day. He and I had differed on something. And he said, I know, Brother Dale, you can take the word and tear me apart. I said, but you also know that I won't do it. You know I won't do it. I'm not what you think I am. You think I'm hateful, arrogant, all things. I'm fighting for your soul and mine too. Even though I knew I could take the word and tear the man to pieces, and he admitted I could do it. But see, the problem was, if he knew I could do it, why wouldn't he have wanted to get rid of what he had? How could have I said anything to him? I would have just ripped him to pieces. I would have destroyed everything the man ever had. Because I'd have said, well, okay, why don't you believe what I'm talking about? And I said, no, brother. You know I won't do it. What's the matter with us believing things for today? The prophet's come. He's gone. Don't misunderstand those things. That's why the Bible says in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, it's still here today, as present as he, I'll say it more, it's more present today than it was when he was standing here. Because now it's all over the world. Right. What? His message. Right. But his message won't do any good until it's revealed. Amen. Now quote him. He said it's laying on the pages of this Bible. But he said as long as it lays there, it'll do you no good. See, that was the problem. It's what I brought it to today with us. We can say we've got the Bible and we take the prophet's message. We've got it. We line it up as the rifle shots. We got it all going. But where's the Christ? See? Nicodemus should have been chosen, and the woman at the well rejected. But yet he never chose him. And remember, at the time, he was not giving out the new birth. Because he didn't get Peter and them the new birth just because he called them. Right? Did they get the new birth just quick as Jesus said, come follow me? Oh, that's a good old Baptist. I ain't throwing off on them. I was there. I've heard it preached. Look at them with eternal life. Look at those people when it happened. They got eternal life. You tell me what was about Moses. He knew the word of who he was and what he was doing. Right? He'd heard it all of his life. But Brother Branham said 5 minutes in front of the burning bush was greater than all of the years he had studied and done and the things he'd done. What did Nicodemus need? 5 minutes at a burning bush. What did the little woman need? 5 minutes. Just using that statement. But you see, she went to Pentecost and received hers. Nicodemus proved his predestination by not going to Pentecost. What What about a man? You take what Nicodemus. You think about a man that knows so much of the word until it would be rolling through his head while he's standing there and talking. And rolling through his head that they was going to beat him, that they was going to, you know, hang him on a tree. Don't you think Nicodemus knew that? He knew the Bible. But what about you and me? Well, Brother Dale, you just act like you want something out of us that seems impossible to have. What? An experience with God. Amen. What did Brother Brown say about a minister? He said no preacher had a right to get in the pulpit until he'd been on the backside of the desert like Moses and met God. But what about people of the message? What about the doing? You realize that if I have an experience, I'm not going to deny the word. Human beings, we might say, I don't understand. But you're not going to deny it and crucify it. May I say this without you getting the wrong thing? See, I know how to read. I know where the prophet said these things. You know what he said if you call a man an intellectual? Now, how much have I been called that? Do you know what Brother Brown said? He said, if you say a man is an intellectual, you're saying it's Satan's sign. That's what he said. You see, I know a lot that's in that message that I don't talk about. Why? Because it looked like it's building me up, but I didn't say that. He said, if you call a man an intellectual, you're saying that's Satan's sign. Because Satan's sign is an intellectual. You remember the priest? He learned it by intellectual conception. The woman at the well learned it by something within her life.
That's right.
That drawed her to this place. Why are you here tonight, this afternoon? I guess somebody say, well, ain't nowhere else to go, so that's the reason I'm hanging around. Well, hang around, you help us pay the rent anyway. You know, I don't mean that wrong. I just like. Because this church wasn't built on trying to get nobody to come here. It's built on the open door that you're welcome to come, but that we don't play games. We try to believe the word. But you see, I can say a lot of things. Brother Branham said it like this one day. He says, there's no way you can leave a church without it being over a difference in the word. You need that quote? Paraphrase, close to it. See? But listen, church. I can only tell you what the prophet said. He said, some people have experiences that they can tell others. I had an experience when I was 11 years old with seeing God in a church. You've heard me tell that. It's not a new thing, so it's not something. And I saw him. Well, from that day till this, I wanted to meet him. Well, see, when Brother Moat began to talk to me about a prophet, I knew the prophets had connections with God. I wanted to know what that prophet taught. And that's why, as I said a while ago, maybe I didn't finish it. You can have all the signs and wonders. And I told Brother Moat, I said, y'all have seen them things. But I said, you tell me what he taught in the Word. I'll know whether he was a prophet or not. I thank God I got the man that could quote 3/4 of the Bible and half of the prophet's message by memory. I thank God. Have you had a personal experience that you can relate back to somewhere in your life?
Amen.
See, I didn't say I was born again at that time. No, no. I've told you my whole story. I wasn't born again when I first come in this message. I was in this message 2 years before I was born again. I've told you that. So just don't get, well, he was born again back there. No, that's what a lot of people would say. I know I'm born again because I believe the prophet's message. The devil beats you there. He's got more experience than you got. He can quote everything he says. Yeah. But you see, church, what about a personal experience? I told you the other day about it. And I wondered, what scripture do you relate to in your life? Because what did I tell you? That when I started reading the Bible, I come over to Malachi 3 and Malachi 4. I go to my wife and I say, there'll be, according to my understanding, there's a Malachi 3 and a Malachi 4, there's going to be two prophets come before the end of the world. Huh? I just let it lay. I didn't try to figure it out. God, we Baptists didn't believe in prophets. Right? I couldn't talk to nobody about it. You know what I done? I talked a little bit to that one day. You know what that old deacon said? You need to go find you a Pentecostal church. I didn't know that's what I really needed to do, but that's what he said. You know. But what about it? When Brother Boat began to talk about prophets, and that was right there. I said, explain this, explain it. He explained it. That settled it. Have you got anything you can look back in your life? Anywhere, from a child to a teenager to an adult to anywhere, to us old age folks. Something that you can say, God spoke to my heart. And I remember it. He may not have given you a scripture. That's what everybody thinks I'm saying. He may not have given you an experience as others have, because he's different. He deals with everybody according to their nature.
Right.
He may have given you a scripture somewhere that you relate to that scripture.
Yep.
May I say it this way without you getting it wrong? Why did some of you women keep your virginity and not give it away? Okay. You said, but Brother Dale, you shouldn't say it. Why not? I praise and honor that statement. I can't say I kept mine. But I can say my wife kept hers. Why? What made you that way when everybody else went the other way? And folks, listen, come on. Get it off your little upset feelings. That don't save nobody. More happens, more forgiven. More honor. Right? Jesus never throwed off on Mary Magdalene. But he never gave her no more honor than he did anybody that had saved themselves. But I ask you the question, why did you save yourself? Well, there was just something about it, Brother Dale. That's what I'm talking about. It was just something about it. Because that's what it is with a little woman. There was just something about it. She read the Bible. There was just something about it. When the man came, she said, that's him. I read you the quotes from the prophet. She didn't have to sit down and figure it all out. She believed it. But is there something you can relate to? My wife, we're sitting listening to tape one day when we first heard of the message, beginning to study a little. And she looked at me and she said, If he done all the things he done, he must have been a prophet. You know, that could be her whole experience. That could be your whole experience. Some scripture, let's see. Help me, Terrence. There's one scripture that he always held to. Quote it. You have to tell me, because I remember the scripture. But you told me a scripture that you always, something about.
Romans 8:31.
Why does that stick out? Wade says what? Genesis 1:26-27. What's yours, Brother Donnie? What sticks out to you?
1 Thessalonians 4:16-18.
2 Thessalonians, or what is it? 1 Thessalonians.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. What scripture stands out to you?
John 3:16.
What scripture sticks out to you above all things?
She said John 3:16.
Yeah.
Today, what they're teaching in John 3:16 restores Christianity.
Oh, yeah.
Mine, Hebrews 13:8.
Hebrews 13:8. Okay. Somebody else, give me a scripture. Sister Jean, hey, let's see if I can remember. No, go ahead, because I can't get it. I've got the paper. I know where it's at, okay? Go ahead.
John 1:1.
All right. Brother Boyd?
Hebrews 11:5.
What about it, Brother Larry?
Psalms 91:11.
What about it?
23rd Psalm for her.
Who?
23rd Psalm.
23rd Psalm? Okay. Somebody, give me.
Psalms 37.
Do you realize what I'm doing? Why does that stick out to you? And why is it? How many answers? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. At least 10 people gave a scripture that means more to them, and not a one of them said the same thing.
Amen.
Not a one quoted it the same way, the same thing. I thought we were members of the body of Christ. If we're members of the body of Christ, then the word's going to have to be parts of the body.
Right.
Yours is an arm, yours is a leg, yours is this, yours is that. We put it all together.
That's right.
And I don't care if mine wasn't being fingernails. But you understand. The little woman had a little understanding. That's what held on to her.
Right.
And when it come to the day of Pentecost, that was what was given eternal life. Peter said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." The day of Pentecost, that was made alive. See, it's too simple, folks. It's just too simple to understand. I thought it was a great mystery. You mean something that's in your life? Something that is within your experience, within your personal being, that is not affected to anyone else of that form? You mean that's not something like the little woman at the well? Now, if you'd have asked Nicodemus, he might have gave you a scripture. Let's say Nicodemus said, okay, my favorite scripture, Isaiah, what is it, 9:6, about, behold, a son is born, a child is given, etc. What if he just said that?
and you looked at him and you said, Nicodemus, why did you turn down the Messiah? Because he's Isaiah 9:6. Why would you turn down the Bible when it's Genesis 1:26 and 27? Romans 8 or whatever. 8 and 1 or whatever. 23rd Psalm. You mean that's not enough to hold you? That's not enough to anchor you in Christ? I'm trying to get you to see something personal about yourself that's related to the Word of God. I thought Brother Branham said, the believer's in the book. Amen. This is not a written thing. This is about people.
Yes, right.
Amen. This is names. But you know this difference, so let me clear up a lot. Now, if I get the names wrong, you put it right. There was two there called Martha and Mary. You remember? If I get it wrong, you straighten it out, okay? One of them was a busybody running the house and cleaning up everything. Yeah. Now, hold on. Was it Martha? Now, you get it right the way it's supposed to, because it's going to come out right in a minute. The other one was sitting at the feet of Jesus continually listening to the word. You remember the Bible? They condemned her for that. A busybody of fixing a house up. Right? I invite you to go find out who was the first one that came to Jesus. You'll find out it was the busybody lady that took care of the house. Check your Bible. Ain't too good on Nairns, were pretty good on situations. Do you understand what I'm getting at? Maybe you can't relate and say, I've got a certain scripture. I've got this or I got that. You know. But find yourself in the Word. Find yourself in the Word. See what stands out to you. Ryan's got his testimony he's going to tell one of these days. We've all heard him tell his testimonies of things. What about your testimony? You remember that time we had a wonderful time? One year I just couldn't get on my mind of anybody to preach, and that was 3 months before end of the year, and I just couldn't get anybody on my mind. I could call this and I could call that and I could call this and I could call that because I had 3 months. I could call them. I could be way ahead, you know. And I come in one day and you remember what I'd done. I said, we're not going to have a preacher for Watch Night. We're going to have a testimonial meeting. And I want every man, woman, and child to get up and testify, sing a song, read a scripture, preach us a sermon, or whatever you want to do. Just be ready. I don't remember who it was, but I know Wade was a minister then. I can't remember. I guess Aaron was. But anyhow, I told him, I said, y'all better be ready. I said, somebody's going to have to preach. I said, because we're going to start at 8 o'clock, and by 8:30, we're going to be through with the testimonies. Right? That's what I thought. We're going to be totally through, and y'all going to have to preach till 12 o'clock. We started at 8 o'clock. Sang a little bit, started the testimony. At 1:30, I had to stop the testimonies. I said, we are supposed to take communion as quick as we can after midnight. You realize that was 3 hours and a half or more? From 8:30 to 1:30. and there was never a dull moment. And it was never, okay, now come on. Now, Sister Gail, you come up and you say so. And you know, now, Brother Richard, you get ready quick as you get through. It was one after the other one. A little boy, what was his name, Brian? A little Brian, he come up here. He took the microphone. He was about probably 6, 7 years old. I don't remember. He might have been a little older, but somewhere close to that. You know what he said? He said, I just want to thank Poppy for letting me call him Poppy. Said, we may not be the same color, but said he's my Poppy. Or Pawpaw or whatever it was. It was a wonderful time. Because everybody was up to doing what we asked to do. And there wasn't as many people here then as there are probably right now. You know, I may be wrong there, but it might not, you know. I know there wasn't as many people there as there are here now. I know that. Well, you know, as far as the church and the doing. But do you understand me? Why was it to Peter, thou art the Christ? To James, it was a different thing. To John, it was a different point. You can agree with John because what did John do? John, because see, the book of John and Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John was not written at the time. It was only written somewhere around AD 50. It was a recording of the scriptures they were writing. They weren't pinning it down as they were going along and then writing it in the book, you know. But what about John? What about John and his writing? In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. He wrote a great understanding. What about the Apostle Luke, who was not an original disciple to follow along and never had no records to make? He only could read records that others had made because he was not an original apostle. And he says, and I love it, he said, having perfect understanding. And I thought, who in the world could say that? You know, there wasn't nobody could say that except Luke.
Right?
See, Brother Branham had a personal God, and what would he do? How was it that he'd take his Bible, stand it, and let it fall, and what did it fall to? Joshua. Joshua. He'd just take it, said any time he'd stand it up, and it'd fall. See, he had something personal. You said, but that was just for the prophet. No, sorry. The other people that I've been talking about today were not the prophets. I want you to just think in your life about your life. What brought you from Sister Anna from a Catholic background and a doing, you know, and all? What brought all of you where you're at? Come on. What brought these from the foreign countries to Lula? Right? A personal experience. So now you say, well, what are you talking about? Because you started off talking about why must we be born again? Because you can't be born again without a personal experience.
That's right.
Nicodemus never made it. And look at all that he had. But now we throw off on him, and I know what the scripture said about it. But what about Judas with all of that understanding?
Right.
Now, I don't agree with all of this stuff they got today going on that Judas didn't do that. Now, forget it. We got the Bible. We know what happened. But you know what? When the man saw he was wrong, he had a great repentance. But it wouldn't work. Esau sought it with tears. Didn't work. Why must you be born again? Because you cannot enter the kingdom unless you're born again. You can know all of the wording of it. May I quote Paul? But have not, know all the mysteries. But we have not Christ, what are we worth? Zero. I never did understand. Come on, musicians. I still don't understand today. They keep trying to tell me that when you're typing this in on the computer, you got to type in not a zero, but a zero. I said, this is confusing to me. I mean, zero means zero. Wherever you got a zero, it's just a circle around and all the way back. And they say, well, when you got that line running through the zero, it means a positive zero. Oh, boy. I ain't got no sense to think all these things out. But they'll tell me, said, type that in, but don't put a zero. I said, what do you want me to put? Said, put an O. I put an O instead of a zero. Okay. Yeah, you do it. I don't have no problem. Here, you do it. That's what my thing at the house, you know, they'll say, tell them what the password is here. It's so-and-so, but not no zero. Or ever what it is, I don't know. Where's Richard? He's got the idea about it. What about it, folks? Let's stand.
I'd like to share something.
Go ahead.
It'd be real quick. In the hustle bustle of Christmas, you know, I just don't take any time for myself. Most women don't. And I was going in the store, and I just said, I talk to the Lord all the time. Lord, I just love to have a poinsettia for myself. Mm-hmm. I just want a live one. Mm-hmm. And I went in the store, and they said, oh, man, we've been sold out for a long time. We got home Sunday from sharing Christmas with sharing Christmas with our kids. There was a poinsettia sitting on my front porch. I had no idea as of yet where it came from.
Because you asked for it.
It dropped down from heaven, I
think. Because you asked for it. What was it about the little boys, you know, that made the joke on the man, you know, and they put a package on his porch, food to eat and everything, and he come out thanking the Lord for all of the things. And the kids, or who it was, people come up and said, that wasn't the Lord done that. We done it. He said, Lord, thank you for the food and the devil that fetched it. So, whoever we get it from, go ahead. What do we got?
We're going to do 260 in the spiral book.
Forgive me for being a little lengthy. I just want to get that off my heart. It won't end off my heart, I can't tell you that.
When the saints are gathered home, we will gather when the crystal sings. When the Lord himself puts me in his glory burn. What a gathering of the people that will be. What a gathering of gathering at the sounding of that glorious jubilee. What a gathering, what a gathering of the faithful that will be. When the angel of the Lord proclaims that time shall be no more, and we shall gather at the same.
I don't have any voice left, don't worry.
And to meet again together, oh, that bright and says no snow. What a gathering of the faithful that will be. What a gathering, gathering at the sounding of that glorious jubilee. What a gathering, gathering, what a gathering of the faithful that will be.
a lot of things, but why must you be born again? Why must you be born again? If the new birth is a birth of the Word, do you realize the Word is not written until you find your place? The Word's not written until you find your place. What a gathering,
a gathering at the
sounding of
that glorious jubilee.
The Word's not finished yet, folks.
What a gathering, gathering, what a gathering of that faithful light will be.
We're not an addition
to the
Word.
Great and final
judgment. We're not in the last pages of the Word.
Come to life. Are sounding and the angel band proclaim and triumphant streams of glory jubilee. Then the mighty join the singing song, Moses and the Lamb. What a gathering of the people will be. What a gathering, gathering at that end of that glorious jubilee. What a gathering, gathering, what a gathering of the faithful.
Anybody up here just have a name?
When the sounding of the trumpet, when the saints are gathered home, we will meet each other by the crystal sea. When the Lord himself from heaven to the glory.
The devil, he's just moving around.
Gathering of the faithful, that will be. What a gathering, gathering of that glorious jubilee. What a gathering, gathering, what a gathering of the faithful, that will be.
Think about it. You are part of the Word.
Amen.
Now, nobody, am I quoting Brother Branham? Nobody can't take your place. Is that right? You got something to do. Just find it. If it's cleaning the house, cleaning the church, if it's cutting the grass, if it's running, what, doing whatever we need it. Do it. You might find out that, like I said about the little woman, that she, the one that was thought about being the one that didn't know very much, but she was the first one to come to Jesus. And she said, Lord, if you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. He said, your brother ain't dead. He said, just show me where you put him. Huh? What about it? Lord Jesus, we love you. We just thank you. We're sorry for being a little late this afternoon, but we wanted to get a background enough to say what we wanted to say and then try to get it said. So now you go with us as we go our separate ways, going home and take care of us. And bring us back together on the watch night service, our Lord, and bring our brother to bring us the Word. Because we truly pray as we know somebody else is going to preach We pray for ourselves, Lord, that you'd make sure and take care of us and give us what to be said. But when somebody else is going to preach, we ask you, Lord, to allow them to say something that'll help us, because we need it. And then we accept whatever it is. If it's correction, we say thank you. If it's exaltation, you know, exalting, Lord, we say thank you. We love you. So just have your way. Let your loving grace be with us. Take care of everybody on the way home in Jesus' name. Remember now, no service Wednesday, 8 o'clock Thursday. All right. You're dismissed.
And the wine. He turned the water, turned it into wine. In a little Canaan town,